I think you're muted, Jamie.
Unmute, please.
Hello. Here I
Hello.
am. You know the drill. We're recording for other people who can't show up today. So I'd like to welcome all of you who are here in our virtual field and thank you for bringing your attention and your hearts to this conversation that is so vital. The climate scientist Catherine Hayhoe has talked repeatedly about how important it is to keep the topic alive, to keep talking about it, because as we know, things that aren't spoken get eclipsed by so many other things that are going on in life. And yet, this conversation for me is really at the heart of what's important right now. And as somatic movement therapists and educators, we know the importance of stewarding the life of our own body as a way to be present with ourselves and the world. And because we are students of embodiment and students of the dance that animates life, it feels incumbent upon us as a community to really begin to bring this sense of ecosomatics, earth consciousness out into the world as something that's not so fraught with darkness, with fear. In fact, so many of the people that I follow on LinkedIn are people who are really working with the planet, working with the earth in biomimicry, really following the planet and the ways of the world to restore life. So this is all happening now. And part of this series has really been about inspiring anybody who shows up or listens to this talk to think about what can I do? What can I do? Because we all have a piece to play in the puzzle. We all are part of the puzzle. And it's about our creativity and our willingness to step up into action that is vital. And of course, there's thousands of ways, and I've hoped that this series has illuminated people who, in their own way, are finding what they can offer. So I'm really pleased today that in our conversation, that, what I do originally is I have kind of a conversation online with different guests and kind of get a feeling for, oh, what are they up to? What are they doing? And who would match well? And I'm really happy to bring forward today Cynthia Winton Henry and Tara Rester, who I know from different parts of my life, but I mean, for me, they're like soul sisters because they both embody play and spirit, and in particular, the dance. And the dance to me feels like it is one of the doorways into the mystery. And so with that, I think I just wanted to like launch in with Cynthia telling us an origin story she shared with me, because part of our origin stories and our inspirations that sometimes come from out of nowhere are important pieces of information in guiding us into our calling, even if we have no idea what that looks like, but the spirit is there speaking. So, Cynthia, please.
Thank you, Jamie. I'm just so happy to be here with both of you and to you who have joined this conversation, and looking forward to hearing more from you as well. I thank you for this interesting lead-in. I was a dance major in college at UCLA, and I was in the throes of trying to sort out, what do I know about this dancing thing, and how does it make sense for me? One of the things that it led me to was time in Africa, trying to understand and feel like what would it be like? What, how could I remember what a dancing body, what a dancing culture feels like? I was a devout young person, very connected already to a sense of spirit, and found that in Protestant communities where people were actually saying yes to my dancing, oddly enough. And so here I was in college, and I was asking these questions about depth, that what was happening deep inside of me. And I remembered asking my professor, what about the history of dance in the church? Like, what happened there? And she rolled her eyes and she said, "Oh, whatever. Maybe you should read this book by Ruth St. Denis, Early Modern Dance, Igniter, and part of the breaking away and open from just the balletic traditions in the West in our experience, right?" And so I took this book home and I was reading it in my little Culver City apartment. And as I was reading through, there was a story that Ruth told, and she was keyed in on this whole other way of length. She was in relationship with one of the early Sufi wisdom guides that brought back the dance that brought well brought the dances of universal peace. Just really an amazing igniter, catalyst. Teacher to Martha Graham. So I'm reading her book, and she talks about one night she's in this green room getting ready to perform, and she had a vision, and the vision was of the Church of the Divine Dance. And I was like, whoa. And I'm reading her vision where all the arts would have a role where beauty would be at the root of the whole connection and community and expression, and definitely it was based in spirit and a deep sense of devotion to this whole reality of our human earth connection. So I'm reading this, and then I heard a voice in my inner ear, and the voice said, "Come into the living room." So I did. I went into my little dusty living room. I lived there by myself at the time, and then I heard, kneel, which was very odd for me because I was anti-kneeling. At that point, somebody had asked me to kneel to receive a Bible, and I thought that it was like wrong, not right. I'm not a kneeler, so. I got this instruction, and I got down on my knees, and then I felt this energy come through the top of my head down into my body and my spine, and this movement started happening inside of me, and I was feeling that this movement was not coming from me. I was being moved, and as this sensation happened, my vision opened up, and I had a sense of looking through the eyes of something so much greater than me, so much greater than a human could ever see. And I had the sense in my body that as I was looking at everything for these few seconds, I was experiencing unconditional, neutral regard for everything. It was such a profound experience, this neutrality, this great sense of regard, that I just had this outpouring of love, an utter outpouring. Like I could not restrain the love. And it was like an upwelling. And I said, "I want to do something to serve this. What can I do?" And then I was just lightly aware that I'd been reading about Ruth's book. From Ruth's book, this vision and this Church of the Divine Dance. And I heard in myself, probably as much as anywhere, whole dance and religion together. And that's, the energy lifted. I kind of came back to myself here in my early 20s. And that moment has sparked an innate knowing that I have never, I wouldn't want to let go of it for personally, but it has certainly got me into a lot of trouble because holding dance and religion together, especially coming out of a white colonizer lineage, is an education. And it's a challenging to look at how my lineage is both one of the springs of hope, but it's also one of the devastators of Earth and Earth wisdom. So that's my initiation story.
Beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. It's like hearing the second time, I get it in a different way. And I'm wondering if the host can keep all three of us on the
Thank
screen
you. Yeah.
so that we're seeing each other while we're speaking. That would be awesome. Thank you.
Thank
S
you.
so Tara, just any responses to Cynthia's story, anything it lit up in you in terms of service, dedication, spirit, dance.
Well, I'm deeply touched by your story. I felt a real calmness come in into my body, and also some moments of, oh yes, I've, because I ask a lot. I ask for help a lot. And that has changed over the years. I was raised Catholic, and I let go of that at a rather young age with help from my mother. She was ahead of her time. But I ask a lot. And these days I ask spirit in the form of places that I am. So let's say I'm going to be doing some work in a certain forest. I might go ahead of time and ask the trees for guidance. And so I really related to your story, Cynthia, of having this experience of understanding and a broader perspective coming into your body. And now I just trust that within myself. And I think, probably most people would just think I was completely a wacko. But that's okay with me because, I'm trusting it. And the other little, like, personal, I had not quite so grand of an experience, certainly. But several years ago, I had this young mother ask me to work with children. And I had worked with children for a number of years. I had let that go rather intentionally and was working mostly with adults. And so when this young mother said, "Would you work with children? We'd like for you to start a nature-based program for children," I said, "Gosh, thank you very much, but no thanks. Right now, that's not what I'm doing. I'm coaching women. I'm really fulfilled by it, and blah blah blah." Well, she would not take a no. She asked me over and over, and finally, I said to her, "Okay, I'm going to this conference. I was presenting there. It was all like 800 women. Amazing." And I said, "I'll think about it while I'm there." Well, I had this dream, and in the dream, I was nursing that woman's child.
Wow.
Well, in waking life, that would have been physically impossible. I was already past childbearing and nursing years. And I was with a dear soul sister of mine who Jamie knows, Odysseia Morley. And we discussed the dream the next morning. And Odysseia said, "Tara, I think that in the dream you're giving that child your spiritual milk." And in that moment, I knew that despite all of my no's, I was going to have to say yes.
Right.
It's like, I don't believe it. I'm going back to working with kids again. This was not part of my plan. Well, it was part of a plan. It was part of a plan, and it's a divine plan. And I'm doing it now. And I consider that woman who wouldn't take the no. I consider her like a goddess mother of the programs that I'm doing now. Because if it wasn't for her persistence, then might not be doing what I'm doing now.
So interesting.
And I want to really applaud the work you're doing, and I want you to say some more about it, but I kind of want to weave into this conversation a quote that I've loved for a long time, and especially since you said the thing about, that it's kind of considered weirdo or whatever, when we talk about these kind of extraordinary experiences, but they're timeless. And not only are they timeless, but well, so there's a Confucian scholar named Mencius in the 4th century BC who tells of the tendency in humans as they move out of childhood to throw away their minds. Thereafter, the whole of life is to recover the lost mind of the child. And in that circling back and forth into the realm of mystery and magic and awe, Tara, that I'd like you to tell our listeners a little bit more about what you're doing with this place-based nature education and what you are, the seeds you are planting in these young souls and nurturing.
Thank you, Jamie. Well, I want to preface that because of something that you said at the beginning of the conversation, Jamie, which is about supporting anyone who's here with us today and anyone who listens to this recording in following their own inner knowingness, whether that comes through hearing the voice that says kneel, or whether that comes through a dream, or it comes through this conversation or any conversation with a tree or with a two-legged. I want to just say to you, trust your body, trust yourself, trust your heart wisdom. Because I think what was one of the reasons I was saying no, and this is, I rarely would admit this, especially in a public space. I've even told my husband many times, like, don't ever talk about this when we're with others. I felt embarrassed to work with children. I'm just putting that out there because I want you to know how vulnerable I felt, embarrassed and even almost ashamed to work with children because it wasn't sexy enough. Okay. That, of course, was just a bunch of BS. But it was something that I was running inside. And I was doing amazing work for years with children. One of the only, actually, at that time, one of the only people doing expressive arts work, by the way, since this is as meta community, doing expressive arts work that I knew of with children. And I was embarrassed to talk about it in mixed groups. I was fine talking with the parents and talking with people in my inner circles. But when I would go places, like big public places or places with my husband, and he has his guest comes who's like from the UN or like famous people, or I was just like, Ken, don't even talk about, I don't want you to talk about. So I'm just saying all of that to help anybody, even if it's one person that's listening to this conversation, trust yourself, trust what you know is right. And go with your heart. Working with children, now I'll loop back to Jamie's to the answer. It's my wheelhouse. I am so comfortable. I love to work with adults too, but I'm so comfortable. It's my wheelhouse. And part of that has to do with play. I'm just like, I'm right there. I'm like, we are completely in this together. So what I'm doing nowadays, and I'm grateful for it, is I'm lead teacher and director of a forest school out here in West Marin, which is coastal Marin County in California. And my husband and I just started a nonprofit called In Place, because both of us have been working with children and adults doing place-based nature education for quite some time and using an expressive arts approach, which makes this just caveat, which makes this somewhat unique, because most of the folks we know, and we know a lot of them, that are doing environmental work, nature-based work, environmentalism, conservationism, all that, naturalists, not very many of us are using the arts. So Jamie had wanted me to address what is place-based or place-centered. Well, there's nature education and nature, so nature education and nature connection. We all know what that means. And those are general terms. So place-based is really about specifics. So place-based is focusing on direct experiences with the myriad of beings, of presences that are in a given place. So when I'm with my students, for example, we are creating intimacy, friendships, wisdom sharing with those specific trees, those specific gray foxes, quail, whoever is living there, those ladybugs, maybe even it's, the wind pattern, but whatever is specific to that exact place. And that changes from place to place, which is so beautiful because each place is unique. And so we're celebrating that diversity. But I'm quite focused on my home place most of the time.
And what's lovely about that is thinking that in terms of our theme of the dance, it's kind of like each place is its own dance partner, right? So you're dancing with all of these various places based on what is there in the here and now, as opposed to I'm just going to do the same dance I do, whether I'm in a studio or here or there, but what is this relationship evoking in me? How do I respond? How do I co-create with place, really by attuning to what is? And so Cynthia, I'm just kind of curious if you're rolling with anything around that.
Boy, yeah. I taught for a little while at the Sophia Center, which was part of the Matthew Fox and Brian Swim effect in Oakland. And I was asked to teach, well, maybe I offered it, a course called Earth Wisdom and Body Wisdom. And I kind of intuitively recognize that you can't do earth wisdom unless you're in outside. And then we can't really do it if we're just going on a, like, a one-time visit somewhere. Like, in order to know something, I really need a relationship. And that means over time, consistency and presence, and through seasons and time. And it's not just my relationship as observer, but it's the relationship of Earth to me, Earth observing me, Earth incorporating me. So for about 7 years, both inside of that class and outside, I had this practice of going to Redwood Park and to this one specific spot over and over through the seasons, with others. So also relationship in community. So that's really interesting to me. It's not just this individualistic thing that we've turned it into, but community-based, co-regard, co-connection, and really the interplay of what's happening. And I carry that wisdom with me today, and realize how slow that kind of relationship is. I mean, it takes me a few years to have a friendship. Do you know? It's dating. It's like, do we let do you want to hang out? I don't know. Do we got time maybe once this year? It could take a while to really have that sense of consistency and connection, as well as the love affair. So I'm just so grateful for place this year for your wisdom and practice and that opening that up. Like, I feel like as an educator and a practitioner, wisdom practitioner, I'm just tickling these things in myself. I can barely practice them because I live in the resonant fields around me. You know, I have to really look for practice, for practitioners, for bodies and playmates. And like right now I live in co-housing in Fair Oaks, and that's a community base. It's actually an eco-housing community, meaning we care to pay attention pretty much. You know, we have some advantages because we're paying attention, but we're still alongside everybody else. And just, I still feel like I'm just barely touching what folks of like over indigenous eons, there, you know, I walked in one path in New Mexico where that was so deep, where the people had trod, you know, back and forth. It was so deep. And my friend Amy says, just imagine how many people walked that and what that meant to have known that, to have known that path as a body in community for so long, and what that would open up, right? And so also as an arts practice person, I believe that the arts, it's not like just walking and observing kind of in this detached way, but the actual engagement through movement, through dancing and singing and telling, and I'm a big practitioner of spontaneous practice, which we now call expressive sometimes. Spontaneity, I think, is actually a signature of the deepest aspects of our energy systems. It's structured through spontaneity, through freedom. And so by being able to be together in ways that allow that, the ladybug, you know, dance, the and the care and the kindness of that. It's just, I think we can't get to the big openings unless we have this kind of practice. We stay in modernity's ruts of looking at. It's very hard to open up deeper kinds of knowledge and support systems, the more magical ones, if we're not able to dance or sing or tell our stories or be spontaneous. Together. So I think this is really huge, radical activism. And like Tara, you say, it's often a sense of being unseen and weird and off to the edge. But I, like in my body, I hold it right in the center. And I have learned to do that. It hasn't been easy. I also feel like a flake and this is really flaky work. According to the story we're currently living in.
I always call it the weird work, just to acknowledge it's the weird work. So get over yourself. You know, it's just the weird work. And think about that. No one is any older than 5 years old.
It's a sign.
Right.
Right. I like really. That.
No one is older than five years old.
Two W's, weird work.
weird work. Right? We all want to laugh. We want to play. We want to be seen. We want to be loved and love. I mean, it's all there. But I also want to make, because I want to affirm the community that arises in sharing place together. And I also want to champion the solo quest as well. Because I know for myself, being out in the environment and really just really listening, receiving, particularly when I'm using my camera in kind of a photographic journey, just to really see a little deeper, to close in the field and notice that there is something about that journey that is kind of is the counterpart to the shared experience of bringing things forward. So I just want to champion the cause of introverts and those that want to be in the mystery on their own, and then bring back to the circle the expression, what was uncovered, which of course we all know the poet Mary Oliver, and because of her wonderful journeys in her place that she inhabited for so many years around Provincetown, she brought to all of us and touched so many of us with the wisdom of her words and the clarity of that connection between soul and body and place. Yeah.
Yeah.
Always good to take a breath in all of this excitement and activity. Yes.
I really appreciate both of you. And I appreciate everyone that's here. I know this is maybe a little off topic, but maybe not. When I'm in these kind of circles online, it always kind of surprises me how present the circle is. I would have never guessed that. I was absolutely, we have to be together, bodies together, where I could reach out and, you know, touch Cynthia, touch Elizabeth, but here we are, and it's like, it's a real circle.
Yeah.
So I just want to say thank you.
And our ability to have that virtual connectivity, from my perspective, also draws on a different part of our perceptual intelligence that we're still kind of dancing with, because for many of us this is new, I mean basically since the pandemic, but it is part of, I would say, our collective evolving sensibility to sense, to embrace. And you know, it's not like a zero-sum game, it's one thing or the other, either I'm virtual or in person, and right, but there's all the gradations of relationship we're able to have because of the technology, and what I like to think of as the right use, the mindful use of technology to, in a sense, connect us from disparate parts of the planet and really spark each other. But thank you for naming that. Yes. What do you think, Cynthia? Is it time for a poem?
I was just flipping through this book that I pulled out, that a poem's written long ago with my colleague Phil Porter, who's the co-founder of Interplay, and he's also a beautiful graphic designer. So it's like beautiful. Oh, look at this. And here's one that's kind of about play. And it's called Mess Around. So I wrote this really quite some time ago, and I think I still think that. I still know this. It's Mess Around. Fooling around, that's how most things get started. Babies and other good ideas. Eventually, fooling turns to crafting. Discipline clasps hands with exploring. Do you want to mess around? Play is the mess of relating improbable partners, bumping, colliding, penetrating each other. It can be dangerous, but don't let that stop you. Can you play? The big challenge is not to fix the mess with ideas of how things should be, or worse, as others say they should look. Fool around, play around, mess around. An artist's job is to mess a step ahead of ourselves, ahead of our pictures, surprising ourselves with all this bumping up against things. Me against you, past against present, human against holy, foot against sky. Fun is chasing a thread through chaos.
Fun is chasing the thread through chaos.
Messing around. Yeah. Yeah, you know, I was teaching at Ghost Ranch, and talk about an amazing land space where so many artists have landed, and seekers, George O'Keefe's, you know, home place. And as I was there playing and wandering around, I just felt the power of all of that at play. And I at one point I gave this instruction to my little group, try to confuse your body. So this is kind of like the opposite instruction, right? For like I just often do a very incremental process and try to get things out. So nobody's like totally freaking out or anything like that. But at one point we were well into it. And I just said, no, we're gonna do this dance. We're gonna dance and then we're gonna talk. And I want you to first move, but try to confuse your body. So, like, if I say dance and talk, you're probably going to think, okay, I'm going to move and then I'm going to try to say something meaningful or coherent. And I heard myself confuse, try to confuse your body. And I think what the messing around part of myself was saying is this might be a shorter, faster way to open past the pathways that I've set up to think that we have to be conscious and wise. I just recently heard that only we're science thinks maybe only we're maybe only 5% conscious, and the rest of us is unconscious. Well, I think, well, then we definitely need the arts, because if you want a pipeline and dreams, right? You want a pipeline to wisdom, then you want to be able to tap these other parts of our knowingness. So unconsciousness doesn't mean unknowing. It just means like, oh, there's so much more juicy stuff. And our forebears, the ancestors, the indigenous leaders and elders to this day are trying to say, oh my God, people, dancing is the way. It's like that's what we do. That's how we do it. And it's not just about an act, it's really about tapping, cultivating access to this powerful land of intelligence of that's way below whatever we call consciousness is. Anyway.
And I'd say that messing around is fundamental, because if we look, and Tara gets to see this so directly, the play of young children, the movement of attention from place to place, the sensory motor involvement, that really most what we call art is just kind of a refined play. But at the basis is that play, is that sensory discovery. And just like many of our somatic approaches are returning to the basics, developmental movement patterns, right? The repatterning of the body to remember what I like to think of as our original grace, that we just move in these ways. It's like evolution is not this one-way street, but we're constantly cycling back and recycling all of those early movements, forms of expression, to, in a sense, rediscover that access point. And so I like to think of young children and animals being our teachers of movement, expression, and consciousness. And so, Tara, take it away. Since you are up close and personal with that process all the time.
100%,
Yeah.
100%. And I'm also a grandmother now, and I love watching the movement of my two grandsons, almost one and just turned three. The movement is just like I could literally just watch the movement for hours. It's just delicious. Anyways, I just did what you were saying about art being play. I just did, like a few minutes before this started, an Instagram post on that very thing. On Wednesday afternoons, I hold an art class in the forest that I called Forest Arts. And the class has gotten really silly. It has gotten really, really silly. It's like these kids are, they're like in this silly, funny, almost like they're stand-up comedians at times too. like very witty. It's physical comedy. I mean, they're like all over, they're rolling on top of each other, they're riding on each other's backs. I did not know that this was going to happen when I set this class up. You know, we sat down the first day and we wrote, I made this beautiful bulletin board of all the different kinds of arts that we might play around with when we're together. And it's just turned into this comedy most of the time. But what's interesting is, and I really let that go, but I also check in with them. You know, like I'll say, okay, so you know, I'm just aware of the time, and if you do want to do some visual arts today, it might be a good time to come over to the table or to choose something. Well, you know, it's very interesting, and luckily that all the parents know me and really trust me, because you
That
know
helps.
that does, honestly it does,
Yeah,
because they're
sure.
paying money for this, and it's like, okay, kids are just playing. Yesterday, speaking of silly improvisation, but see, this is also very place-based. So these 2 7-year-old girls come, and by the way, you'll love this. All of you will love this. One of them has not worn shoes since last June,
Wow.
even in the winter. That's like her signature thing. She's 7 years old. So she and her best friend come barefooted, and they're smelling leaves. And I noticed they're smelling like, really into it. And then other kids are watching, like, whoa, they're really into this. And then one kid goes, just great. He didn't like it at all. Eventually, these two girls take the leaves and stick the leaves up their noses. Now, if this was a 2-year-old, you know, we know we'd have to be very like, you don't want them to get something up it. But these girls are older and they know their bodies. I trust them. I trust their bodies and they trust their bodies. But they've got the leaves literally like in the nose. And I'm like, okay, this is amazing and weird. Totally, Jamie, weird and wonderful. It's weird and wonderful. Like,
Real.
okay, I wasn't expecting this. And then they eventually came and sat down and started doing needle felting. If any of you know what that is, it's taking wool, colored wool that's robed wool, and there's special needles, and you go like this, and it binds the wool together and makes felt. And they started making leaves out of felt. And then they ended up making carrots with leaves, like the fluffy top part, and one of them was eating a carrot. And then this mom shows up at pickup time with a book, and on the front cover are carrots. Three kids ended up making carrots with leaves, and I'm like, all right,
Wow.
great, whatever, right?
Yeah.
But it all started from them initiating this kind of silliness, but this was actually related to something that was deeply sensory, which I was tracking. You know, it had to do with smelling and really deeply smelling and what that was doing to them. And I thought, oh, wow, okay.
Could I ask a
Interesting.
question?
Yeah.
You know, I think this thing that's very curious about, obedience, disobedience, structure, spontaneity, this thing, and that children are, they it's not they're not all grooved up yet, right? In terms of neural pathways and teachings and all of that. So they're like right at that intersection of obedience, disobedience, or piety, lack of piety, or and all these pictures that we get, and that children are just complete, they're just not that, right? And so when we talk about that Confucius day thing, Jamie, about, yeah, we're all trying to get back to this child. Well, I'm not really sure we are, really, or should we even want to? Do you know how do we do, though, get that level of freedom, of that level of care? Like, Tara, how does that, like, your willingness to let that go? Can you talk about that? Your what do you know about that?
Well, honestly, it's come from years of practice, because it's honestly, it can feel scary to let go, actually. Of course, we could have an entire hour and a half talk on that one, on that theme, but I mean just even working with children. And I think it for me, it has to do with when I'm with them, I'm tracking on multiple levels. I'm also tracking risk. And, you know, like I mentioned about the thing going, you know, the leaves going up the nose, really, that's real. A really obvious one going off on a slight tangent is the same afternoon, but not with that same group. There were two kids who climbed up into a Douglas fir that I've never seen anybody except for the men that we hire to trim dead branches go into it. It's very high off the ground. The lowest limb is very high. They figured out a way to get up there. And inside, I was like, whoa, this is a little scary now. Okay. But it's really a, it's, I think it's really about tracking and also not like, you know, taking a deep breath, regrouping within myself so that I don't respond to them or react actually to them from this kind of fearful place of like, stop, you know, or even just, hey guys, be careful. It's more like, oh, okay, what's happening now? Oh, the risk is that. Okay. You know, it's like coming in, it's tracking them and monitoring my own self. And because I'm so playful and I love the creative process and I'm used to things being weird, messy, uncomfortable, extremely uncomfortable, self-judgment, all of that stuff. Because I'm used to all of that, I'm able to just flow with it, with myself and with them. And I think that's huge. And that doesn't come when you're in childhood. Like to your point, I love the Confucius quote and I love, you know, the Picasso quote that's similar. But I think I've never thought of it that way before, Cynthia, and I really appreciate that. I don't want to be a child. I want to be me, my 64-year-old self, and I want to be able to have access to that wow, creative, messy, like go for it part of myself.
And I would
And
say that
the
that's really the thing, how to recover the lost mind of the child in an adult body, in the adult body of experience, so that can still lighten things up as well as dive deep into what's happening. And what I loved about your story about watching them climbing is your use of sensing inside yourself, right? Kind of that self-regulation that happens while simultaneously witnessing them, feeling into how to respond. And I would say those qualities are so fundamental in facing planetary dysregulation, right? Because there can be so much a sense of the emergency, right? And how to be aware of the urgency of action coming from being reflective, sensing, messing around with possibility, and supporting people in expressing what's alive for them. And I think, you know, all of that, I'd say all three of us share that as educators, as facilitators. And I'm very aware that we've got 6 minutes to wrap up our first hour before we go into conversation with our witnesses. And so, anything that you want to kind of wrap this up, or where you find yourself now in our conversation?
I think I want to just affirm the like these like children and players somehow have an affection and curiosity for the real. and that the real life is dangerous. And we want that. We want the element of facing into like death. Death is real. It's right here. I might go up this tree, but this is part of where I belong, you know, and there's danger in it too. And the elimination of danger, the litigation, the insurance, all the strategies that we're contending with in every institutional negotiation, these are all about eliminating danger. People grabbing their 11-year-old's hands, running across the street, not letting the 11-year-old cross the street. You know, no play for you, no risk, and no beauty. Too, you know, you don't get to play, you don't get to create, and you don't get to invent. And I just think that creating, you know, for me, the call to create and to be in trouble is really is a makes it's a it's helps me be where we are in this journey with the earth, to create as and have the beauty of it, the curiosity, and to know that we're in trouble. I can be in trouble. I know how. I've been there. I'm still in trouble. But for me, you know, it is a call to be in trouble, to experiment. Yeah,
right. And so much trouble on the world, in our beautiful living earth and in our world. Yeah, I think for me, what comes forward is that the human body is wild nature. That's that's my experience and my belief. And that we can develop an ability to listen to our own body's wisdom, and we can help others do the same. And I do that with the children. So when those kids were up in that tree, yes, I was afraid. And I thought, what could happen? Okay, if someone drops, maybe a leg breaks. Okay, that's not the end of the world. Like, that's the kind of conversation I'm having inside myself. But what I say to them is, how is your body feeling? I see you up there. How's you're like birds up there. What is it like? What do you see from up there? They were so amazed and empowered. It was incredible how high up they were. And I said, and they had to shimmy up this self-made thing that they did to get up there, by the way. But anyways, I said, how does your body feel? And if I notice that they're like, oh, they got it, like in that kind of frenetic almost, I'll ask them, all right, I'm going to ask you to pause and take a breath. And I'll even call a name, you know, for that. How does your body feel? Please check in. That's a way to help them learn to do what all of us as adults are trying to do. So I would say that's big, a practice that we can step into this beautiful, messy, weird current world that we're in.
It's beautiful. The power of the pause, the pause to sense what's going on. So as we finish up this hour, I'd like you both, if you could, to put in the chat any links, how people can contact you, anything you want to just, you know, to keep the connectivity going. So there's two of my sites. My nature being art site is the site with the videos I've created as kind of a way to let the natural world infuse you as you settle into your screen. Because of course the screen is the common denominator of our current cultural life outside of the common denominator of the earth. So I might as well use it to instill beauty and support that urge for beauty. You got your websites and stuff in there? Good.
Working on it.
So we're at the top of the hour, so I want to thank those of you who are just here for the hour for coming and lending your attention, your presence, your open-heartedness to this conversation. It was a beautiful field to participate in. And we're going to transition now into overtime for generalized conversation with our guests and with you, with all of our guests. So,